Good afternoon. This is Jennifer Warner, and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast, Reservoir Management for Water Quality and Supply Planning. We're really excited to bring this content to you today. The Water Research Foundation held a special topic session at the AWWA annual conference in Dallas this year. We recognized that we had at the Research Foundation four very interesting projects to describe regarding reservoir management, having to do with both water quality analyses and management and also water supply planning analysis and management. And so we wanted to bring this good information to the annual conference. And for those of you who did not have a chance to attend the annual conference in Dallas, we're offering this abbreviated version of the special topic session to you today. I wanted to let you know that we do have four unique presentations and four unique topics. We will hold all of the presentations together in consecutive order. You are free to ask any questions you may have for any of the presentations that you hear in the presenters today in the question box in the lower left-hand side of your screen. We will have a question and answer session at the end of today's webcast, and we will get to as many questions as we can. If we don't have a chance to get to all of your questions, be assured that you'll have an opportunity to see the answers to the questions in the webcast recording that will be posted on the Water Research Foundation website about a week or two after today's event. So I wanted to keep my introductory comments very brief since we do have four very content-rich presentations for you today. I want to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Kenneth Wagner. Dr. Wagner holds degrees from Dartmouth College and Cornell University, with his PhD earned in natural resource management in 1985. He has over 34 years of experience working on a variety of water resources assessment and management projects, many focused on drinking water. In 2010, he started Water Resource Services, a small company with a focus on water supply protection and lake management consulting. Ken is a former president of the North American Lake Management Society and the current editor-in-chief of Lake and Reservoir Management, a peer-reviewed journal. So the presentation that we're going to start off with today is Water Research Foundation Project number 4222, and Ken is going to give us one of two presentations based on that very rich project. And the first one today is on rapid monitoring and water quality modeling, as reservoir management strategies. So with that, I introduce Ken.
Good afternoon. This is Ken. Boy, I'm feeling old after that introduction. I've got to rewrite that sometime. The rapid monitoring and water quality modeling are two of the three parts, with aeration and circulation processes as the other one. So we'll come back to that one at the end. We're going to start with the monitoring and the modeling. They do go together, and you do need some monitoring to get your modeling done, but it doesn't necessarily have to be rapid monitoring. All right, here we go. Get the slides to move. When you're managing a reservoir and you want your best water quality, you really do need timely data and predictions. Now, okay, what's rapid really mean? We're usually talking real time or near real time, and you certainly don't need that for everything. I get a little concerned in that these rapid or remote monitoring things are starting to replace people actually going out there and getting in touch with the reservoir and the watershed, and we don't really want to do that. The reality is almost all of the rapid monitoring protocols still require people to go out and calibrate and see things, so it doesn't really replace field activities. It just augments them and supplements them. It means you can get much faster information. One of the biggest drawbacks I've experienced in helping utilities manage their raw water supplies is that you don't have the information fast enough to make quick decisions, even if you have the ability to take those actions to make the water better. So it's a trick. The technological advances of the last decade, really keying off of a lot of computer things and telemetry and things like that, have really made this possible. By rapid monitoring, some of the options I'm talking about, simple things like handheld instruments, even though you may be there with it, you're getting, you know, an oxygen value back immediately as opposed to waiting for a lab result. Same thing for conductivity, temperature, pH, turbidity, things like that. There's rapid reaction kits, including algal toxins, where you can get results very quickly. Visual imaging, everything from satellite type of big picture stuff down to doing algae on a flow cam, an instrument that lets you get immediate pictures back and you can tell what you've got in terms of algae, which can be extremely useful. I do a lot of algae work for utilities, and there's just no way that I or anybody has the capacity to give them immediate feedback all the time, and sometimes that's what you need. Various remote sensors, some of the common ones that often go with the telemetry would be things like turbidity, pH, conductivity, light, temperature, oxygen, and phytopigments, which includes chlorophyll, and more popularly now, phycocyanin, which is a blue-green algal pigment. It is in some other algae, so it's not perfect, but, boy, that's a great one for knowing if you've got blue-greens out there. And if you've got a big reservoir and a lot of ground to cover, it can be extremely helpful to know this stuff quickly. There's a lot of useful relationships. In this somewhat cut-down version, I'm not covering a lot of them. In the original talk, we discussed a lot of the different things that relate to each other and how you use them. I just threw out here as an example, conductivity, which is really a measure of the electrical conductance of the water, but it relates proportionally to dissolved solids, which in turn tends to relate to sodium, disinfection byproduct precursors, alkalinity, a lot of other dissolved substances in which you may have a distinct water quality interest when managing a water supply. And if you have something like the image here where there's a little blip in it going down into the depths, that may mean something. That may be something you can take advantage of. So getting that information quickly before it changes can be a great help. The other is in detecting trends. Now, you can certainly do trend analysis with basic old lab data that you collected for years and years. And, in fact, years of data is often what you need. But even on a shorter time scale, the variability in a lot of things we're interested in, water clarity, turbidity, pH, can be pretty substantial. Certainly over the course of a day you'll get variations, and there may be something there to know that's worth dealing with. But if you only have a little bit of data, you may not be able to pick out the trend. Having a lot more data is important, so these remote or rapid biomonitor monitoring protocols often give us fast and more expanded results so that you can create these relationships more quickly. The monitoring lessons that have been learned so far, you've got to be collecting case histories and looking what people are doing in different reservoirs. Calibration of mains is critical. This is not a case, if you haven't done this, where you can stick the instrument out there and walk away and just collect your data for the next year. Pretty much everybody goes out at least every 2 weeks. Some cases you might get away with longer, but fouling is an issue for a lot of the instruments. You've got to maintain them. Reservoir-specific relationships can be derived. They're extremely helpful. There are a lot of known relationships. I can give you an envelope back feel for how parameter A relates to parameter B most of the time, but knowing exactly how they relate in your reservoir can make you that much better at managing the water, particularly if you've got multiple levels of intake to work with. Early warning, that's probably the most important aspect of rapid monitoring. Again, if somebody gives you your algae data 3 months later, it's not doing you a whole lot of good for that year. It may help you with future planning. But knowing right away how much chlorophyll, are there blue-greens, or is the pH skyrocketing, is the turbidity wave coming down the reservoir after the last storm, those are things worth knowing that can affect how you manage your water. I did throw at the bottom that there's no such thing as too much data, but as most of you know, there is such a thing as too much cost. You really have to balance that. At what point is enough data enough? And that's a fair question to ask. So what are utilities actually doing? Well, there's a lot of use of remote water quality sensors going on. Certainly the larger reservoirs where it's just harder to get the staff out there, you actually save money by doing it this way. I suppose it's save money if you're actually doing it. In some cases, they just don't bother and they don't have the information to work with. There's an increasing use of fluorescence probes for a lot of things, including phytopigments. It works reasonably well. It is not a substitute for the old-fashioned spectrophotometric extractions and such because you still have to calibrate them. There's some amazing instruments that if you calibrate them in lab with set cultures and it's a type of algae you know you have out there, you can literally map the distribution of specific groups of algae. It's pretty impressive. And if you have a large water supply prone to algal problems, that can be very useful. There's a lot of experimentation with rapid imaging for particles. They're moving to image analysis systems, but right now you can at least get a pictorial spreadsheet that will break things up and you can see what you've got. We're developing a lot of reservoir-specific relationships. I've seen some really good work done by utilities where they know when, you know, the alkalinity hits this point, it's going to mean a change in treatment. Or when the turbidity hits that point, they have to start looking for taste and odor issues, things of that nature. It is still remarkable, though, how little information is being collected in many cases. You should take advantage of these opportunities. Now, the water quality modeling side, obviously you need data to make models work. But that doesn't make them perfect. And I put some quotes up here. They're some of my favorites. Second one's actually mine. Models can lead to a lot of frustration. And a lot of this, from what I've seen so far in the case history analysis, comes from people trying to apply too complicated a model for the data they have. They're all pretty much data-driven. You can do a lot with very little, but you're going to have big error bars, a lot of possible error around it, and that leaves you wondering. Again, there's a lot of levels of modeling. A lot of people don't think of some of these order of magnitude estimates as being models, but they are. It's something as simple as knowing how deep your reservoir is. If it's normally more than about 25 feet, it's going to stratify in the summer. But if you have a 10-foot swing in your water level, you'll know if it's going to destratify. Things like that that you know from experience, and I do find that utility managers have a great wealth of this. They haven't codified it. They don't necessarily write it down. But they do know these order of magnitude estimates. You know, if the wind's coming out of the north, you're going to have this problem. If it's a particularly hot week, we know we'll get that problem. They know these things, and they're very specific, but they're out there. The next level up from that is empirical equations, which are basically simple relationships based on real data that don't say how anything works. Just more phosphorus means more algae. More algae means more blue greens. These are simple relationships for lots and lots of data. They're not going to work for every reservoir every time, but they do give us a general idea of the direction of change and the magnitude of change that we can expect when something changes in our reservoir. We move up to GIS and spreadsheet models. Those are really products of the last 10 to 15 years where the computers have made this possible. They're really useful. They're not that expensive to run. Single-digit thousands to a few tens of thousands, you can do a nice model. If you have the data to calibrate it, it'll give you great ability to look at things on a steady-state basis. That is, you can't say what's going to happen tomorrow, but you can say that if I have these conditions, over the long run, I'm going to average X for this parameter and Y for that variable, whereas if I don't do this, it's likely to go in this direction. They're really excellent for that sort of general idea. When you're going to put something into service, out of service, you're looking at the impact of development in the watershed, very useful models. The limited input mechanistic models, and I'm going to show an example or two of these, are actually older and are kind of black boxy. They're done on computer, but older versions, and of course they've improved over time. But these are ones that take advantage of empirical equations but give you some reservoir-specific input to put in and make predictions. And then we get to the high-input mechanistic models, mechanistic meaning that it's not just making an empirical relationship. It's literally saying, if I get more phosphorus, that means that the algae can take it up. They grow at this known growth rate when they have this much, and they have saturation constant of X, and it gets very, very complicated. And they'll level off after this point, and we can throw light into the equation. There's a lot of stuff going on in these. You can go really wrong, but as I found in doing the case histories, you can go really right, and you can get some major enhancements and ability to predict if you do these well. Okay, just a few examples because some of these aren't necessarily apparent. GIS and spreadsheet models, you know, you're going to get this spreadsheet or a graphic image, and you can link things to it, and it'll make calculations, and out the other end, you get an idea of what the condition in your reservoir will be. For the limited input mechanistic models, to give an example, bathtub or flux are really well-known versions done by Bill Walker for the Corps of Engineers, applied on a lot of reservoirs, hundreds of them, over the last 15 to 20 years. And they're basically these adjustable algorithms, nothing more than an equation, that you can plug in what data you have, get predictions, calibrate it by tweaking certain parts. What you're seeing in the image there are predicted versus actual values for things. The predictions and the actual are pretty darn good as an average. Pretty good sized error bars around them, but in general, if you're trying to get a sense for what will happen if I do X, Y, or Z, these will give you a good feel, and again, not for a huge amount of money. Now, it's when you get to the high-input mechanistic models that you have to ask yourself, do I need it, and do I have the data to run it? The flip side of that is if you're dealing with a lot of different variables, the human mind just cannot wrap itself around more than three or four things happening spontaneously. As a result, if you've got water inputs coming from all over, outputs in different places, temporally or spatially variable loading of the contaminant, it's real hard to keep track of that on a piece of paper or with a spreadsheet model or a lot of these other things. You need these more complicated models to do the job. Large systems, multi-reservoir systems, places that have a lot going on in them can really benefit from this, but they are data intensive. You can make estimates and plug them in, but the error bars start getting so big that you have to wonder, and the price time tag gets so big. I have not seen one of these run for under $100,000, and it's not uncommon to see it be $200,000 to $500,000 for the modeling effort. So realize that if you're going to do it well, you probably got at least twice that in data collection costs, maybe over 10 years, and then a pretty big bill to make this work. But if you're in a big system where there's millions of dollars at stake in how you run it, it's worthwhile. Another one, that last one was just showing a watershed schematic. Here's a schematic of a cross-section of a reservoir. Still look pretty scary. I'll grant you that. I'm quantitatively oriented, and I still find these a little intimidating. But all they're doing is creating equations between all these different things based on the data you plug in and then giving you predictions for what's going to come out at one end or the other as you need it. Extremely useful, usually done by consultants. It's not something utilities typically do in-house, but it behooves you to be familiar enough with them so that you can ask good questions. All right, model applications, the kinds of things we do with them. Effects of changing storage, and that may be forced on you or something that you intend to do. Effects of mixing or oxygenation, extremely popular because those are big buck systems. They can do a lot for you if it's properly sized, but knowing how to properly size it is not an easy thing unless you're modeling it. The effects of nutrient loading and management, particularly looking at build-out scenarios in watersheds and what it might take to buy key land parcels as opposed to doing more treatment. The influence of various water sources that you could choose from, bacterial transport and die-off, a lot of things that came in with the Safe Drinking Water Act amendments in the mid-90s, any contaminant fate and transport work, and results of alternative watershed strategies. These are all things that can be evaluated with the model. Frankly, you can't make these predictions without a model. So determining which model apply, that's the tricky part. You know, what's the question you're trying to answer? How complicated is the system you're doing it with? What do you have for data? Those are the biggies. After that, all right, what kind of time frame do you have to make a decision? How often are you going to do this? I mean, if you're going to make a complicated model to answer one fairly simple question and then get rid of it, you have to ask yourself if that's worthwhile. On the other hand, if you're going to be managing the supply in the future and you can see the changes coming down the pike, it's worthwhile. And then the cost. And certainly that's a big factor for a lot of utilities. Nobody's going to tell you it isn't, but you do have to weigh the pluses and the minuses there. Okay, some of the application tips, always start simple. I find that you can use empirical equations or simple GIS-type models very inexpensively. As a result, that will enable you to get a quick handle on where you're going with this. And when you see the level of variability involved, you can decide if you need to move to the next level or not. Certainly know what the modeling can deliver and limit your over-expectation. A lot of people do expect that you just believe everything that's given to you in terms of the numbers, and that's usually not the case. They're going to give you a direction of change and a magnitude of change. Never worry about the decimal places. Get the data you need. Estimate as little as possible. Estimates, just, you know, they're assumptions, you know what they say about assuming it. Can be very dangerous. Facilitate reality checks. That's all about the data. I've created a model called the Lake Loading and Response Model. It's a GIS and spreadsheet model. I use reality checks at every step. Otherwise, I just won't believe it. Performing the following up modeling to track what's going on and revisit the model. Most of them are adjustable. You can make them better over time. Okay, so what are utilities actually doing? Well, I think there's not nearly enough conscious use of the order of magnitude estimates. I think it's done unconsciously a lot, and I really worry with the current brain drain and the baby boom retirement burst that we're going to lose some of that information because it's not written down, it's not passed on the way it ought to be. but it's extremely useful. The increased in GIS and spreadsheet model use is obvious. It goes with computer power. It's very simple to do. You could do that for yourself. It does not take a modeling expert to do these. There's quite a bit of reliance on the limited input mechanistic models. They've been around a long time. They're tried and tested. They only give you general impressions of what will happen over a longer period of time. You can't effectively model short-term bursts. But if you're looking at long-term changes, it's definitely a way to go. And the bigger systems tend to be doing the high-input models. When I started this project, I had a generally negative impression of the cost-benefit ratio on those, and my mind has been changed. Where it's been done well, they have saved money by doing these models, even when they're spending $1 million. Where you put that intake, how you blend the water, what your structural or non-structural changes should be make a huge difference to that final product. So the value and limits to the monitoring and modeling, well, the monitoring and the modeling are partly what make adaptive management adaptive. They give you the tools to go, okay, let's change this, or let's go about this, or let's protect that. It gives you predictive capacity and quick feedback that can help you improve the product. And it can reduce costs, although you're still going to spend some money to do it. You've got to look at that balance. It does require effort and funding. It's not free. It's not easy. You can make mistakes, and it can be frustrating. And it doesn't get the job done by itself. It just shows you a direction to go in. But it's an extremely useful tool to have in the toolbox. I believe that is the end for my part, so we will turn it over to the next speaker.
Thanks a lot, Ken. I want to remind the audience that the project, or the half of the project that Ken just presented, will be completed by year's end, and we hope to have a publication ready by mid-year of next year, 2013. So I want to introduce our next speakers. We have two co-presenters for the next presentation. Both are with Hydrologics, Dr. Daniel Scheer and Dr. Megan Rivera. Dr. Scheer is the founder and president of Hydrologics. Hydrologics is a 12-person firm that helps to manage water and river basins that contain about 20% of the U.S. population. In his 40 years of experience in water resources, Dan has helped create management schemes and management agencies for D.C. Metro, New York City, Las Vegas Valley, and many other suppliers. River management plans also for Kansas, the Delaware, the Susquehanna, the Potomac basins, and South Florida and many other watersheds. Dr. Rivera has been a senior water resources engineer with Hydrologics since 2005. She specializes in collaborative modeling for decision support in river basin management. Prior to working at Hydrologics, Megan was on the civil engineering faculty at the City College of New York. She earned her doctorate in civil and environmental engineering from Stanford in 2003. Dan and Megan are going to give us a look into dynamic rule curves and ways in which reservoirs can be operated dynamically. With that, welcome Dan and Megan.
Thanks, Jennifer. Let's see. Before we get started, I just want to thank Water Research Foundation for their support and guidance and also getting this webinar together. This is really fun. And also thank our partners on this project. They're all listed here on the slide. Special thank you to Hazen and Sawyer and Riverside, who play a major role in this project. We're going to talk about just a little piece of the project today, but I wanted to give you a little bit of information about the overall project so that you know what's coming in the future. The overall goals are to demonstrate the potential value of dynamic reservoir operations, and I'll explain what that means in just a moment, in improving system reliability, resilience, and performance under challenging climate conditions that includes climate change. We're also seeking to provide utilities with really practical guidance to decide if and how to implement dynamic reservoir operations. And by dynamic reservoir operations, what we mean, it's not really, there's not a clear cutting point between dynamic and static operations, but dynamic operations tend to be more flexible and capitalize on more information than what you might call static operations, like a annually repeating rule curve. There's a big long list here, and these are some of the things that your operations might be conditioned on. The first research question that we're looking at and what we're going to talk about today are what techniques are currently used to develop and implement dynamic reservoir operations, both theoretically and in practice. And as part of the project, we're getting at this question through a literature review and then also by putting together an operations database. Dan's going to talk about that.
The operations database that we're trying to put together is to help utilities find rules that are well-suited to achieving water management objectives. This is a water management-based database so that you can go in and try and find ways to manage your reservoirs that will help you achieve particular objectives. We hope to organize it to find the relevant information very easily. We hope to provide a wide variety of operations examples dependent on the complexity of the system, the kind of climate that the system experiences, the different kinds of management objectives in particular, and the investment needed to design and implement these kinds of rules. Throughout, our intention is to emphasize the role of management objectives in designing operations. There are, of course, many, many purposes for managing reservoirs. All water utilities are interested in managing for the reliability of water supply. Many utilities find themselves in the unenviable position of trying to manage as well for some flood mitigation while still managing for water supply, and these are two conflicting objectives. Also, many of the systems are required to operate for environmental protection and sometimes environmental enhancement. Sometimes for hydropower, sometimes that hydropower is to the benefit of the utility itself, and often for recreation. It's important to realize that while you are considering all of these objectives, the operating rules that you use often optimize for the short term, and that's a surrogate for performing well in the long term. In the simplest case, if you have a rule curve on your reservoir, your short-term operation is to get as close as possible, that is, minimize the distance from the rule curve, with the hope that doing that will provide for good long-term performance of the system. I have several slides that show different kinds of operations. The simplest water supply operation, of course, is if you have a reservoir that has a water supply attached to it, you don't take any water from the reservoir except for water supply, and that keeps the reservoir as full as possible. That's the simplest of all possible cases, but it's rarely that simple. In most cases, at the very least, there is water needed to provide a minimum release from the reservoir. And one of the things you can do with dynamic reservoir operating rules is to make sure that the water that you have to release is released at the times when it is most beneficial, and less releases are made at times when the water is less beneficial. This is an important kind of concept for thinking about dynamic reservoir operation. More complicated are when you have two reservoirs in series. The simple rule for water supply reliability is to keep the water upstream. That way, if the upstream reservoir spills and there's still space in the lower reservoir, you don't lose any of the water. This is the simplest water supply only rule. But quite often, you have to balance that by balancing the levels in the reservoir for recreation or other economic impacts, maintaining levels for cooling ponds, maintaining aesthetic values in reservoirs are all a part of this. And if you look at dynamic reservoir operations and look what the likely inflows to these reservoirs are, there is at least a certain amount of balancing that can be done without any cost to water supply at all, and a balancing that can be done in addition to that at minimal cost to water supply. This is taking a bit. When you have reservoirs in parallel, the rules are a little different. What you're trying to do is to minimize the spill from the entire system. Often this means keeping the reservoirs that are in parallel, that is on different streams, balanced so that the probability of spill from those reservoirs is minimized, the sum of the probabilities. And a simple rule that does pretty well at that is called the space rule, where you try and bring the free volume in each of the two reservoirs in parallel as close as possible. You keep a ratio of the free volume to the average annual inflow as close as possible together. And that works pretty well in most cases to minimize spill.
So what we'll be doing in the database is give examples of these sorts of rules, both in terms of the forms of the rules and then also specific examples from different utilities. And it turns out, of course, when you're balancing all these management objectives, the specifics of how you do it are specific to the system. And clear performance measures are really key in striking that balance and finding the win-wins that are there. Performance measures are displays, and I'm going to show you one in just a minute, that basically allow you to assess better or worse for a specific management objective. The releases that you make can be tailored directly to those management objectives once you're quite clear on what they are. They're also helpful because they can foster education and understanding among water users. And as I alluded to, they are used in multi-objective analysis. So if you have a number of performance measures that you need to operate for, you can really see those trade-offs and win-wins.
And it's very important to look at all of them in order to balance them.
So one example that I want to spend a little bit of time on is around floodplain connectivity. So this would get back to the example that Dan talked about, case two, where you have you want to keep as much water in the reservoir as possible for water supply, but you do have a downstream need as well. And I picked floodplain connectivity because it takes a lot of water, so it's kind of a juicy one. In this case, it may be that you learn from ecologists that it's really important to maintain floodplain connectivity for a certain period of time, perhaps, say, 25 days, and that it's also seasonal, in this case, from May to September. So right from the beginning, as you sort of key in on the performance measure, you can see, all right, there's going to be certain times of year. There's also going to be a period of time that's important.
And it's very important to realize on all parts that this doesn't happen every year naturally, and when you're supplementing, you don't have to do it every year either.
Yeah, and that's really illustrated in the graphic of this performance measure. If you look all the way at the bottom left, and I've circled that portion, we've plotted here both, say, an alternative that we're working on, so that's the green line, but also the current operations in black, and then run-of-river operations, meaning if you just kept the reservoirs full, what kind of performance would you get? What floodplain connectivity would you get at that point? And that's in the gray dotted line. So you can see when it's really dry, the reservoirs just can't help you very much.
And it's very important to compare not only the performance under alternatives, but the performance under natural, quote-unquote, conditions.
Yeah, and let me just say one thing to orient you a little bit to this plot. I'm not quite done there. Dan, are you okay? Something fun had to happen when we present. So in this case, you see the x-axis gives you percent of years. So this is a simulation. This is a long-term simulation, and we've just sorted from lowest to highest. And on the y-axis is the acres of habitat that are connected to the main channel. I've also circled a midpoint on this graph, which is where the alternative the alternative operations that we were looking at is not actually doing as well as the current operation. So that's something that we wanted to deal with. And I want to mention that this amount of connected floodplain, that number of acres, is about the median flow at this point. So it's a lot of water. Okay, so when we're designing operations to try and meet this downstream need while at the same time conserving storage, the first thing that we learned, even just by looking at the performance measures we have so far, is that during droughts, we're just really not going to be able to do much. Even run of river isn't able to support that floodplain connectivity. We can tailor the support to the need. So since 25 days is important, we can, say, supplement for 5 days. We can do trial and error. That's the last bullet here. We can do trial and error to figure out how many days of supplementation helps to trade off between the storage and the need for floodplain connectivity.
And the models required to do this depend on system complexity, and so they need not cost very much for simpler systems.
The red line here shows the alternative with this additional operation that we support that extra 5 days up to a certain point, and it actually exceeded our expectations. We're doing a whole lot better than both current operations and run of river with that supplementation. So, again, I like this example because it requires a lot of water, and yet if we look at how much storage is actually used, it's very little because we're really targeting the use of water at the times where it's most beneficial.
So for very little water, we can achieve a lot of benefit ecologically. When you're looking at dissolved oxygen, quite often in the real world, there are static minimum flow requirements for reservoirs to provide dissolved oxygen. But there are a whole lot of things that you can do to maintain the oxygen standard while using a whole lot less water. For example, oxygen depletion is much, much less, and oxygen saturation is much, much higher when the weather is cold. So temperature-based minimum flow requirements can be really valuable. Such kinds of temperature-based requirements have been implemented in places like Atlanta. Using real-time monitoring is something that we're investigating with one of our case studies, the one in Calgary, where when it becomes apparent during the day that oxygen saturation levels are extremely high because of the growth of algae, we will know from real-time monitoring, as Ken said, that there's a potential for having a huge oxygen dip during the night. And upstream, we may have a small reservoir that can release water during the night to supplement the oxygen in that stretch of the river for the night, but not the entire day, saving perhaps two-thirds of the water that would be used for a constant minimum flow requirement. Waiting for the slide. Here we go. So why take a DRO approach? Well, the benefits can be quite enormous. In studies that were done in the 1970s and 80s on the Potomac River, there was an increase in reliable supply equal to the standalone safe yield of 5 additional large reservoirs from dynamic reservoir operation. That avoided multi-billion dollar capital improvements. And I'm not kidding, it was multi-billions of dollars. One very small reservoir operated in conjunction with reservoirs far upstream allowed those reservoirs to be used very effectively to meet demands and saved the need for safe yield reservoirs, 5 large safe yield reservoirs. In New York City, and we worked on this with Hazen and Sawyer, it provided an alternative to constructing a $300 million multi-level intake structure. We found that by conditioning the releases from that reservoir through a tunnel that fed into a trout stream, by conditioning the turbidity on conditioning the releases on the turbidity of the water, which was deemed deleterious to the trout stream, we could use all the water but still not impact the trout stream. In the Kansas River, jointly operating several supplies that required joint operation of reservoir supplies owned by a number of different utilities increased the reliability of supply equivalent to a single standalone billion-dollar reservoir in the Kansas. In order to carry this off, the state legislature had to be convinced to allow for conjunctive management of supplies under water rights, and a new form of organization called an assurance district was allowed to be formed so that water right holders could pool their water and operate it jointly. This was quite an achievement. So the next question is, okay, how do you set out to design a rule? First of all, if you're designing a rule to manage something, you have to know what you're managing for. So you need to lay out all of your objectives as displays, and you need to set up logical rule forms that will do it. You need to set up a way to test those rules. That's generally simulation models. You need to be inclusive. You need to look at all of the objectives, really, and you need to look at all forms of rules, and then design rules that perform well on all of the objectives to the extent possible. You do this by running multiple simulations.
And while you're being inclusive, it's often a good idea to get other people involved as well. Both more brains are better, and you get a better understanding of what their real needs are by having them involved.
You want to take this one?
Yeah, I think we talked about the use of decision support tools, that being able to simulate your rule allows you to, usually via trial and error, but you can also do it with, say, genetic algorithms, that sort of thing, to develop and test potential operating rules. And then we're also hoping to provide support via this database to sort of get you started, so you can look up what your objectives are and then see some examples of how others with those same objectives have formed their rules.
Designing rules is as much an art as it is a science, and you learn art by example, and that is what we hope to have in the operations database.
Great. So let's see. To sum up, choosing your operating rules, both the forms of the rules and the parameters that go into those rules, should be based on the management objectives as using the performance measures, as we demonstrated.
Practical operating rules will often, most of the time actually, optimize for the short term for operating objectives such as balancing reservoirs, such as meeting rule curves, such as releasing the least amount of water necessary to meet several downstream demands in the short term, and that's a surrogate for performing well in the long term. You can optimize for the short term, but your objectives are usually long term.
And the simulation models can also help you assess how well you're doing in the long term. Multiple forms of operating rules can be combined and generally are combined within, you know, a 20-minute talk. We didn't get a chance to build a complex operating rule, but that's how it works.
And finally, we're finding that substantial benefits, including climate change adaptation, can be achieved. We've looked at operating rules for the Potomac and found that we can write rules with some fairly draconian but not implausible conservation measures that can get us through the worst climate change scenarios that we see developed from the global circulation model output or global climate model output. However, those rules, when applied to more moderate climate change or even current climate, rarely get invoked. And so they're feasible for adaptation under even current climate and provide assurance that climate change won't catch you by surprise. And that's it for us. So I'm going to cue up the next slide.
We both did it.
Oh, we both did it.
I'll let you do it back, Dan. Sorry.
There we go.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Dan. Thank you, Megan. And similar to the information I provided for Ken's talk earlier on the monitoring and modeling aspects of 4222, the project that Dan and Megan just featured on dynamic reservoir operations, number 4306, does have quite a bit of research left, including the development of what we hope to be a very useful operational database. So that final product is really not anticipated until the end of 2013. So this is an early look at what you can expect in that project. So our next speaker is Mary Knosby with HDR. She'll be talking to us about a tailored collaboration project, number 4304, on a very interesting river basin in the Carolinas. And this project is largely sponsored by a group of utilities led by the Charlotte-Mecklenburg utilities in Charlotte, North Carolina. Mary is project manager with HDR in Charlotte. She has a master's in civil and environmental engineering from UNC Charlotte, and is a registered professional engineer. Mary's experience includes a variety of water and wastewater engineering projects. She's currently working with the Catawba Water Rewater Management Group on this particular safe yield research project that she'll feature today, as well as their water supply master plan. Welcome, Mary.
Thank you. I'm going to be talking about our project that's been going on for the last couple of years. We're actually wrapping up right now in the final report stage on defining and enhancing the safe yield of a multi-use, multi-reservoir water supply, which is what the Catawba Watery Basin is. Outline of my talk, as Jennifer had said, we have a lot of information to squeeze into a small amount of time, so I'd like to get through an overview of our project team scope and schedule, the basin itself, and then how we looked at water yield enhancement strategies, climate change scenarios, and the modeling results, as well as the qualitative and quantitative review, and where we go from here, how we're using this research. We have quite a large project team, starting with the Water Research Foundation. This is a tailored collaboration project. Jennifer Warner is our project manager. HDR was the lead researcher, and then we also had pulled together a technical advisory committee, our technical advisory panel. You can see the four names there. Bill Holman, who is local here in North Carolina and very involved with water allocation. Neil Grigg from Colorado State, Peter Sutherland works with GHD in Australia, so an international perspective, and Ken Chopel, who also works with HDR out of our Texas office. And then we were able to also work with our project advisory committee, and you'll see their names there, Allison Adams, Mark Woodbury, and David Yates, to also add additional insight and help us through, brainstorming our model strategies and climate change scenarios as we went through the project. And then the overall utilities that participated is what's called the Catawba Watery Water Management Group, which consists of 18 municipalities in North and South Carolina in the Catawba Watery Basin and Duke Energy. The scope of the project initially was to do a literature review, to identify similar reservoir systems and, take a global look at how everyone else is looking at their water yield or their safe yield, then develop our own yield enhancement strategies and climate change scenarios to look specifically here at the Catawba Watery Basin in the Carolinas. So we had several workshops with all the different groups that I had mentioned on our project team, and we came together and brainstormed, a lot of different things to model, understanding that, the modeling couldn't be infinite. We needed to settle on what we thought was best for this area. So we needed to complete the modeling and quantitative results and then take the best scenarios and parlay that into a high-level financial, environmental, and public impacts evaluation and then ultimately prepare our final research report. We began this project about 2 years ago. It was the beginning of the summer of 2010. Worked through the last couple of years, and then just wrapped up this past spring with our final draft report that was submitted in May, and are receiving comments back from the foundation and from our project advisory committee, and our final report is due on October 15th. So going into the background of the Catawba Watery River Basin, this is located through North and South Carolina. It kind of starts at the foothills of the mountains in North Carolina and flows through. The middle of the basin is the Charlotte area, so that is the highest populated area, and I'm used to having a pointer. I'm sorry, the big lake you see there, that's Lake Norman. That's directly north of the Charlotte metro area, and that's where the biggest population center is in this basin. As you can see, it's a fairly small basin, and it's definitely narrow. So one thing to point out is, particularly during this time of the year, and looking at rainfall and how the water supply is in the basin, all these pop-up thunderstorms we have, one area can get 2 inches of rain and the other area does not get any, or you can miss the basin altogether because it's so narrow. It's made up of 11 reservoirs, so the reservoir storage is very important. And the storage volume is really primarily only located in three lakes, and I will show you that on the next slide. But there's one in the upper basin, one in the middle, and one towards the bottom part of the basin. The other thing to mention is some of the return flows. Water can be taken from one reservoir and then returned to the next reservoir. And also the North-South Carolina border is right in the middle. This is what, there's only two riverine sections. The top lake there, Lake James, is the first lake in the 11 reservoir system, 11 interconnected reservoirs. Lake James has storage, Lake Norman in the middle, and then Lake Wylie down towards the bottom part. Right after Lake Wylie is the other riverine section. This is largely operated by Duke Energy. They operate that large power supply here on the Catawba Watery. So when we are talking about safe yield and how we determine that, this cross-section shows how do we define failure. And basically we need to look at the intakes to find failure, the water intakes on the lakes. So basically you have a critical intake elevation for each lake on the reservoir system. And once that critical intake drops 1 foot below, then we consider that that lake is in failure. So as we're running all these model scenarios and looking at all the withdrawals and as we go through time, this was the parameter we needed to use to define failure. The modeling software we used is called the KEOPS model, Computer Hydroelectric Electric Operations and Planning Software. This model was already developed. This basin had gone through FERC relicensing in 2008, so a lot of this work, there was really essentially no planning ongoing here. I mean, everyone was just withdrawing water and Duke was operating, and in the 2005-06 timeframe, the basin users, came together as part of FERC relicensing and needed to start doing some water planning. So HDR was involved in a water supply study directly for Duke Energy to look at the water use projections and where they were going and the safe yield. And then this KEOPS model was developed as part of the FERC relicensing. So as part of that process, the Catawba Watery Water Management Group was formed, and that's the 18 utilities in Duke Energy that I had mentioned previously that came together to work on the FERC relicensing and be a management group, a water management group. And also, interestingly enough, as they were going through this study and finalizing everything, we had a very severe drought here in the Carolinas in the 2007-2008 timeframe. So even more things were initiated to help manage the water in the basin as part of that. So we had a lot of really good things already started in order to do this research project. So as part of the study that was done in 2008, which is the current for this graph that I'm showing, it's looking at net water withdrawals over the next 50 years. So about the year between 2040 and 2058 is the decade that the model was projecting there would be enough failure occurring. And so it's a net water withdrawal, so that middle section is the Charlotte metro area where your withdrawals are greater than your within what's being returned. Always those last four reservoirs, since they're at the tail end and they have less population, less withdrawals in that area, they always have a surplus of supply, but it's that middle area, and you can see the difference in the water projections between the blue and the yellow, how much more significant it is over the next 50 years. Another thing to mention for background information is the LIP. It's called the Low Inflow Protocol. That was also developed as part of the FERC relicense and came in very handy during that drought in 2007 and 2008. And basically what it is it uses the storage index or the drought monitor or the stream gauges or a combination of those to go through the stages of drought. Starting at stage zero and then moving, 1, 2, 3, 4 being the most severe. And basically, I know you probably can't read everything on the slide, but basically what that does is it sets stages of action. So the different licensees and the public water suppliers have to reduce their use. And that could be initiating starting to limit, irrigation and other things that is mandatory by the municipalities as well as Duke Energy, and then just moving through those stages to help conserve water during time of drought. So getting into the Safe Yield Research Project, I had discussed our scope initially, and the first thing we did was a literature review. We looked at a lot of different river basins in the United States, but then we also looked at them globally and in many other countries, just seeing if we can get any good ideas from other places and just kind of see what else is going on out there. We basically, have obviously realized, every basin is quite different in terms of the climate, how they're structured, and what type of control they need to have on their water supply. And the level of sophistication of their water supply analysis is definitely perceived on stress. Any, water-rich areas didn't seem to have as much of a water yield documentation compared to other areas that you know, it had more issues with water supply. Model is definitely the most common way for documentation. And other things we learned was, you know, documenting yield really requires excellent cooperation and communication among all the users. I mean, everyone does need to participate and agree. And any type of conservation and everything that seems to be more demand-side management oriented. So these are the yield strategies we simulated. I guess how we got from once we went through the candidate analysis, then we had several workshops and started brainstorming all the ways we could enhance safe yield here in the Catawba Watery, and we ranked them as high, medium, and low, and chose to really try to focus on our high and medium ranked strategies. So the ones that are in black are the ones we ran initially, and the ones that are in red are the ones that we came through in round two, like how could we improve upon what we had already modeled and come up with some more scenarios. For example, the first thing we looked at is lowering some of the intakes. I had mentioned the critical intake elevations, and if there was areas that we could lower them, you know, could we gain more storage in a strategic place? So then, like, YSO2A was a modification of those other lowering of intakes to see if we can gain more storage. We looked at rerouting some wastewater effluents. I had mentioned some municipalities withdraw from one reservoir, but then the returns go into the next reservoir. So we looked at, hey, can we return to the same reservoir they withdrew from? We looked at overall water conservation in terms of reducing the per capita demands, increasing offstream storage in an area of need, raising the target operating levels in the reservoirs, eliminating interbasin transfer during drought to another basin, looking at reducing the impact of sedimentation in the reservoirs, and then ultimately looking at the future thermal electric water reduce, the electric Duke Energy's electric water use reduction. We also evaluated climate change. As we know, we've gone through the periods of the droughts and the heavy rains, so we looked at different impacts over the next 50 to 75 years of low impacts and high impacts of less rain and warmer temperature, basically just increasing the temperature over time. So our baseline simulation was the one that we all the other scenarios were compared against, so the delta between the two. And we modeled the withdrawals and hydro operations according to the relicensing agreement. And we used the drought from 1998 to 2003. That was the drought of record at the time that was documented at the time we started the study. Knowing we had that other more recent drought, 2007-08, we believe to be more severe. And I will talk about the next steps after this project, but since we already had everything documented for the drought of record from 98 to 2003, that's what we used for our baseline to look at the enhancement to see where we can gain more storage. So the simulation results show the safe yield values for the upper seven reservoirs to be 665 MGD. I had mentioned before the bottom seven, we kind of treat this as two operating systems, the first seven reservoirs and the latter four reservoirs, because the majority of the failures always come in the top seven. They almost operate as two different systems. And this slide is a graph of every, this is a graph of the baseline scenario, but there's thousands of these because for every scenario we run for every lake, there's just the output that you get. So we, the baseline failure occurred in the 2048 to 2058 decade. These are modeled by decade. And you can see where the circle is. That's where the green line drops below the critical or the minimum elevation. So that's where the failure occurred. So for each scenario, for each lake, for each decade, you get a graph similar to this, which shows your inflow, your outflow, your minimum elevation, and then when it drops, when the elevation drops below that minimum elevation line, then that's when you can say you had a failure in a specific lake. Then there's also tons and tons of data sheets that can tell you how many failures occurred and which decade they occurred in. So I'm going to show you just a couple examples of some of the scenarios that we ran, and so this is going to be the scenario in reference back to this baseline. So one of the first ones we looked at was lowering intakes in the upper Catawba. This is like right up in the top couple of lakes. Lowering the highest intake in Lake Rotis and Lake Hickory to lowering their critical elevation so we gained storage in two of those lakes expecting it to increase the water yield. And it did do that. We increased our yield from 10 to 20 years and about 13% in yield by lowering the intakes in the upper Catawba. One of the other ones we had looked at was increasing offstream storage during once you get into LIP stage three. So this was when you get into more of a severe drought situation, being able to access additional storage somewhere in the basin where it was needed. So we looked right in the middle of the Mountain Island Lake to do it there, or put it near there, and that is in the Charlotte area, and it's expecting to increase your water yield by limiting the withdrawals when it approaches the harshest conditions, plus having the additional water supply. And although we expected this to show something, some sort of increase in yield, it actually did not. It just wasn't significant enough, but even though the LIP was working to conserve water and just evaporation being so critical, that was just not enough time. So those are the only two I chose to show you specifically, but here's the outline of all of them that we had modeled. So lowering intakes in the upper Catawba proved to generate yield. The most significant increase in yield was actually rerouting the effluent flows from some of the larger wastewater treatment plants in the Metro Charlotte area. Per capita reductions could definitely extend the water supply, and raising the target elevations in reservoirs. A lot of the others, like the interbasin transfer and the offstream storage, it just wasn't enough for how significant the droughts became. So once we quantified which ones appeared to work and give us additional safe yield, then we looked at a high-level screening analysis to look at financial, environmental, and public impacts, and the blues are the less money and more minor or moderate issues, and then as you move up into the reds, you're getting into some more significant issues. This is, and I know this is hard to read as well, but you can see where the reds are. Rerouting effluent flows upstream was kind of flagged as red because there's a lot of permitting issues associated with that and potentially even some public impacts. Lowering intakes, you know, that was seemed to, you know, especially in the upper Catawba, that could be pretty feasible. We did flag the public impacts because as you lower intakes, if you're in that drought situation and your lake's going to be drawn down more, that's obviously going to expose a lot more of the shoreline to those people living in that area. And it was joked, well, the people downstream aren't going to care if their docks are, you know, submerged because you know, they don't live there. So this was kind of done as a high level with the water management group. And that's the other thing I'd like to mention is everything I'm discussing and all these scenarios and all these strategies and the results and the things that we reran, including this qualitative analysis, we had many workshops with a large group of people to work through this together. So our research summary and key findings, model code refinements, we'd like to take a closer look. The LIP is very sensitive, and we have proven that it is definitely conserves water the way it needs to. But there's a lot of limitations on it in terms of accessing upstream storage, and there's recreation releases, and there's timing issues associated with that. So we would like to look at refining the LIP, you know, for the future. We'd like to combine some of the strategies. We didn't have enough time or money in this project to run more scenarios based on what we proved to be successful. So we want to continue to work with the strategies that did prove successful and continue with the collaboration solutions and consensus on defining failure. You know, if there's one failure, is that significant or does it need to hit a certain point? And, you know, which water intakes, because there's a lot of interconnections, so there could be other opportunities. So right now, what this project's moving into is the water management group is now doing a master plan or another water supply study since we did have a more recent drought and some of the water projections have changed. You know, the growth has declined a little bit, so they want to redo the projections and look at everything more closely and then definitely use all this information that we've gained through this research project to continue working for the area. We want to update the KEOX model and define failure probably a little bit differently. Decide if we want to include any of the climate change scenarios. I mean, that essentially obviously makes the water run out sooner when you start to increase the temperature. And the LIP thing is something we definitely want to look more closely at because there's such a large window of time when you move from stage to stage, and we feel as if we can move more quickly, it could help conserve water upstream. once the upstream reservoirs release water, you can't get it back, so we feel there could be some ways to enhance the water and keep more upstream for later releases. So right there you'll see the list of the water yield enhancement strategies that we want to take another look at and enhance further to do combinations of the different scenarios. And this water supply master plan, we just started with the demand projections and doing those updated, and that should be going on for probably about the next year or so. It's scheduled to be completed in 2013. And with that, I'm finished, and we can move to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. And as Mary indicated, the research report for this work has been drafted. It's under review, and we hope to have a publication out for interested readers by the end of the year. So we're going to get back to Ken Wagner. He's going to give us a look at the second half of Project 4222. We did split this project into two because it is so large and the two topics are so unique and discrete. He's going to give us an idea of how utilities are using aeration and mixing systems in their reservoirs. Welcome, Ken. Welcome back, Ken.
Okay, yep, I'm back. I think the whole project's been interesting, but this part to me has been absolutely fascinating. I went into this thinking I knew a lot about oxygenation and artificial circulation or mixing, and what I learned was not only did I not know probably more than half of what there is to know, neither does anybody else as an individual or small group. It's phenomenal how complicated this is. I know a lot about drawdown as a lake management technique, and that's way more complicated than it seems on the surface. It just lower the water level. How complicated can it be? Well, oxygenation and aeration, again, putting some oxygen in here and mixing up the water. How difficult is this? Well, quite complicated, and there's a lot to know. So I'm going to burn through this and give you some real food for thought, I think. Okay, so why do we oxygenate or mix water in the first place? Well, most of you out there that are doing actual reservoir management know that you get thermal stratification in the summer, sometimes for bigger chunks of the year the further south you go, and you get these physically separate water layers. They're thermally different, the water quality is different, and that deeper water may be advantageous or disadvantageous to take into your intake. The upper water, same thing. You tend to get more algae up top and more reduced substances like iron and manganese down below. That loss of oxygen leads to a lot of things coming out of the sediment, iron, manganese, ammonia, sulfur, and phosphorus. And the phosphorus, if it leaches up into the upper water, then stimulates algal blooms. And to make it even more insidious, you can get algal blooms that are right at that border between the two zones that then can float up at some point. The oxygenation and mixing are really two separate processes. You can oxygenate a lake without mixing it. You can't really mix a lake without oxygenating because the lower oxygen water comes into contact with the atmosphere at the surface, oxygen is going to go in. But mixing does not guarantee that you're going to get saturated oxygen conditions, certainly not down deep. So they are overlapping, but they are different. If you're oxygenating, what you're really trying to do is get oxygen in the water. We often call it aeration because air gets used. I'm trying to wean myself off that term because the object is oxygenating. You really don't want the nitrogen or the hydrogen or anything else that's in the air. We'll take it if that's what we have to have, but it's the oxygen we're interested in. By getting more oxygen in, you can avoid the anoxia, the lack of oxygen at the bottom, and this accumulation of reduced compounds that are almost always undesirable. And you can accelerate beneficial chemical changes for incoming loads. For example, if you've got an upstream reservoir or a river system that puts in a lot of iron and manganese, by oxidizing it as it moves through your reservoir, you can get rid of the iron in a matter of hours. Unfortunately, the manganese takes a number of days, so it's a short detention time system. That's a problem. But there is the potential to make quite a difference in water quality by an oxygen addition system. If you're mixing, you're trying to do the same thing. You're facilitating oxygenation, but not so much by bubbles or anything like that you might use to make the water move. That there will be a transfer of oxygen from those bubbles, but it's really very low. It's about 2 or 3% per yard or meter it moves, unless you've got a really deep reservoir. Most of the oxygen in those bubbles stays in the bubbles. What the bubbles are really doing is moving the water and getting the mixing. So you're getting this atmospheric transfer at the surface of oxygen in, and by moving enough water quick enough, and you literally have to move all the water about once every 3 weeks to make this work, you can keep it from having low oxygen at the bottom. It'll also homogenize the water quality. Even if the water quality is not ideal, most water treatment plant operators would much rather have stable water quality than wildly variable water quality, even if the average is somewhat better. So the homogenization can be a very valuable process, even if you don't get all the oxygen you want. And the other neat thing about it is it tends to disrupt algal growth processes. In particular, it really wreaks havoc on blue-greens, which are a major nemesis for water supplies. When you're mixing for homogenation, the power, the energy necessary to do this depends upon the thermal gradient. So it becomes really important to start this before stratification is set in the spring. The diagram here is just showing a temperature profile over a reservoir that would, in this case, have 16 meters of depth. You can see that somewhere between 4 and 6 meters, there's a major drop-off of temperature. That is a very stable boundary, and that RTR, relative thermal resistance to mixing, those bars are what stick out. Once you hit 40, 50, 60 as a unitless measure of RTRM, it's real hard to break that up. You can do it, but it's not going to happen easily. If you keep it from ever forming and you keep everything mixing, you use much less energy in the long run. If you're mixing to control algae, and as I said at the outset, I'm really an algae guy. That's my original background. I'm into slime. The more time you can make the algae spend in the dark, the better off you are, which immediately leads the question, well, if I'm mixing a lake that's only 10 or 15 deep, how much is that going to do for me? Not a lot in terms of giving them darkness. But bacteria, cyanobacteria in particular, do not like vertical movement. And even a pressure change of 10 or 15 feet can often cause the vacuoles to crush, and you can kill them that way. Diatoms, on the other hand, depend on mixing to avoid settling. They're like little silica boxes, like miniature sand grains. They don't stay in the water very well when it warms up because the warmer water is less dense. They fall out. But if you can keep the water mixing, you can prolong a typical spring diatom bloom into the summer. Now, for some people, they don't want the diatoms either, but you have to take a choice between diatoms and cyanobacteria. Pick the diatoms every time. Greens and goldens are somewhere in between. They can be aided by the mixing, but they can also be harmed. Certainly, minimizing microzones, the vertical zonation that allow different algal groups to take over and really blossom, is a good idea. If you can minimize it, you're better off. And if you equilibrate the pH by mixing with the atmosphere, that alters the carbon sources. The point is, not all algae are created equal, so mixing, there's a lot to it in terms of what algae it's going to control, what ones it isn't, and how it's going to relate to your water quality. You probably can't overcome really nutrient-rich water with this. You won't get less algae, but you'll get different types of algae. Now, the keys to successful oxygenation is you've got to counter the oxygen demand. The oxygen demand is a mixture of what's exerted by the sediment at the bottom and what's exerted in the actual water column. And you have to know how much comes from each, what the total is, and what it's likely to increase to when you start adding oxygen. As it turns out, the oxygen demand we can measure is usually not more than 50% or 1.5 or 2, a factor of 1.5 or 2, less than what it will really exert. So as the oxygen declines, it gets harder and harder for that demand to be exercised. If you add oxygen to counter what you think is the demand, in most cases you need to add more oxygen, because what happens is that the rate of uptake increases. An interesting side that turns out, when you're using compressed air to do it, so you've got air with 21% oxygen in it, the other gases cause enough movement of the water that tends to increase the oxygen demand by a factor of at least 2 and often 3. If you use pure oxygen, it rarely increases the oxygen demand by more than a factor of 1.5. There's something to be said about pure oxygen in that regard. We did not understand that even 5 years ago. Oh, the other aspect is that with the oxygenation is the distribution. You can put a lot of high oxygen water in there, but if you don't get it well distributed, it's not going to get the job done. You've got to get the distribution as well as the amount of oxygen necessary to counter the demand. Well, the same thing goes for successful mixing, but it's a little easier. Pretty much a straightforward function of having, if you're using air, enough air in there to disrupt any stratification. That number turns out to be 1.3 standard cubic feet per minute per acre. It's kind of one of those ultimate truisms. The answer was 46 in the restaurant at the end of the universe. Well, this is 1.3 is the answer. If it's a deeper reservoir, you can scale it down and get away with as little as 0.8 cubic feet per minute per acre. But the reality is that almost all the failed systems I've looked at have tried to get away with 0.5, or it was designed for 1.3 and they only ran one of two compressors, or they shut it off half the time to save money. It doesn't work that way. You've got to provide enough air to keep it mixing. If you're using a pump system, now you need to move the target water. I say in here once a week. The reality is you can get away with about once every 2 to 3 weeks, but if you can do it once a week, you're sure to make it work. And you've got to do it to prevent stratification. You can't let the stratification set up. If you do, you'll get iron and manganese so quickly, and you can't get the manganese back out of solution very fast. So you kind of shot yourself in the foot. It's a preventive measure, not a combative measure. Now, the experience with oxygenation mixing, well, I've been sprinkling that in as we go, but diffuser systems are highly varied, very common, extremely popular about 20 years ago, effective when properly sized, although very few of them were to start with, and when you get the oxygen distribution up and you operate it well, again, a big problem in many cases, and there's multiple air source options. Lots of ways you can do this. Oxygenation through mixing usually is more important than the transfer from the bubbles. Again, as I mentioned before, it's the water coming in contact with the surface and the atmosphere, not the transfer from the bubbles that matter. When it comes to oxygenating but not mixing the reservoir, hypomimetic chambers were really popular in the 80s and 90s. Less of them are going in today because the pure oxygen systems seem to have been perfected to the degree where they're effective and efficient and cost-effective. These systems work. I just did case histories on two of them today, actually four of them today, two places with two reservoirs each. I've been doing it for 20 years. They had break-in period the first few years where things didn't go as well as they'd like. In 20 years, things start wearing out, but it's worked well. They do get the job done. It's not inexpensive to run. It's not inexpensive to maintain, but it is effective. The non-destratifying systems increase that bottom oxygen, and the biggest issue has been either undersizing or more often distribution issues. You've got to get it moved out. So you can't just bring it into the chamber and spit it right out. You either need to have a distribution system that goes with the chamber or space your chambers appropriately so that each one's overlapping and covering the area. Pure oxygen systems have become more popular more recently. I find these fascinating. There's two or three groups that are really doing a lot of these. They are in constant demand. The beauty of them is there's really no moving parts. You can have them with moving parts where you're pumping the oxygen around, but you can also do it where the oxygen, literally going from liquid to gas, drives itself down the tubes and out into the lake. Works pretty well. You do have to have a source of oxygen. You either have to make it or have a big oxygen tank there. A lot of people in residential areas don't like that idea because it's flammable. The distribution is the key issue. You've got to get it distributed out. But so far, what I've seen is with a year or so of startup experimentation, these systems have worked very well. This is a pure oxygen diffuser system here. We are seeing the one tower there that goes with it. And on the right is showing what happened over the course of the year. They started this when it was already stratified and had virtually no oxygen, and it just moved the oxygen concentrations in the bottom half of that diagram way out. You see they're literally at 12 to 14 milligrams per liter of oxygen at the end. Clearly not what they're trying to do in the long run. They want better distribution. This was just an experiment. But what they found in a lot of these is they were designing them to put twice the oxygen they thought they needed and were discovering they only needed the original amount of oxygen up to maybe 50% more. And even though it's expensive, the clients are much happier when you tell them they can ratchet back. So it's worked out pretty well. Upflow mixers, the most common of which people know is the solar bee shown here, tend to be small, lower power systems. They can be run by electricity, wind, or solar. They do the job. They move water. but you've got to meet that water movement every week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks at the outset, and the capacity isn't big enough on a lot of these to do a big area, so you wind up needing a bunch of them. They're supposed to create compensatory circulation further away. There's mixed results on that. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I think a lot has to do with thermal profiles and the shape of the reservoir and the friction that's set up by moving water and countercurrents. There's very limited corroborating data. I know utilities that are thrilled with the results. I know others that have gotten rid of them. There's a lot to know here, a lot more than the research has been done on, but we have some ideas in terms of why it's really working. These other systems, the downflow mixers, the most well-known of which is Weirs, W-E-A-R-S, which is a company out of Australia. There's only two in the U.S. right now, but they're very popular in Australia and several places in Europe, also in Asia. These are big. They're moving a lot of water at a low velocity with an impeller down through this big tube. They're pushing the surface water down, preferably to a depth of around 30 feet. You can make them work around 20. They don't like to go much shallower than that. And the indication so far is that you can take one of these, even with it stratified, and you can make a pretty major change in the water quality over the space of a month. And if you start it up before there's stratification, it does a pretty nice job on a pretty big area. These are large. They're not inexpensive, but they do work, and they work pretty well. All right, well, the technical conclusions. Oxygenation and mixing are different approaches. They overlap, but you need to understand the difference and why you'd use one versus the other. Adding oxygen greatly improves water quality if you put in enough at the right places at the right time. There's a lot of ways you can go wrong there, but there's a lot of ways you can go right. You just have to know what you're doing. Mixing aids oxygenation, but it provides some independent benefits as well. Many mixing systems do not give you oxygen at a high enough level all the way to the bottom to prevent some of the problems, but they will give you substantial improvement, and many of these systems are fairly inexpensive. Sizing and distribution are the big issues. You have to get it at the right size, and you've got to get that oxygen distributed, or you've got to move enough water to get the counteraction going. This is all stuff that can be known, can be modeled, can be estimated pretty accurately now, but it's still a new horizon, a new frontier for a lot of utilities, and it's often tempting to go with something cheap and small. Unlike modeling, where I said start simple and build up, you can't do this as a partial thing. You really have to go all or nothing. Partially oxygenating does not get the job done. Okay, what are utilities doing? Well, mixing is very common where stability of your water supply is threatened by stratification, or you've got wild inputs coming in, big storms. Air-driven systems are still most common. Updraft and downdraft systems have increased in use over the last decade or so, and I think they're gradually taking over because of the lower power costs. Water quality is not always improved to the degree desired, but you get this consistency that really helps with treatment, and you often get control of algal types even though you still have low oxygen in places. Non-destratifying oxygenation has been most common where you have a deep intake. You want to stay away from the algae, but there's issues with iron, manganese, ammonia, sulfide in the deep water during the summer because it goes anoxic. Air input to chambers was most common in the past. Pure oxygen systems are increasing substantially. They seem to be the dominant thing that's going in now. A lot of the old compressed air systems, now that they're wearing out, are being replaced with the pure oxygen systems. That doesn't mean that's always the way to go. There are some really good cases with compressed air that work quite nicely. The costs have been prohibitive in a lot of cases, though. This stuff is hundreds of thousands to low millions in many cases, but they're finding ways to make it work. Some of the really clever stuff is taking the excess air from dissolved air filtration systems and running that back in, or the waste air from ozonation, which is actually oxygen, can be sucked off out of the systems and put back in. Those start becoming more cost-effective because you're taking a waste product and turning it into an advantage. And that brings us to the end of it. I guess we're open for questions and answers when Jen says we are.
Thank you, Ken. That was great.
And as Ken noted, at the end of his first presentation on monitoring and modeling for this project for 222, there's quite a bit of writing up left to be done. Ken is assembling case histories for a lot of the information that you heard today in those two talks, and we do hope to have a publication available for interested folks next year, 2013, early to mid-2013. So we do have a few questions that I'd like to get to. We have roughly 5 minutes left, and a few questions have come in. I'm going to keep on the aeration track since we're all kind of in that space right at the moment. And a question came in, Ken, about water stratification in reservoirs and whether they can cause a variation or whether stratification can cause a variation in water hardness.
Oh, that's an interesting question. Yeah, it could. By stratifying, you separate that bottom layer, and when you lose the oxygen, a lot of things can come out of the sediment. Certainly, hardness is affected by the iron and the manganese in the water. There are any number of other things that come out. You don't see a lot of calcium moving, which is one of the things we think of in terms of hardness. I don't see that it would affect the upper water, although eventually the stuff from the bottom is going to mix in. So the answer is yes, you could get changes in hardness. And if you're monitoring and you're seeing a seasonal change, start looking for it to correspond to low oxygen in the bottom water.
Thank you. One more then, Ken, on this topic. You mentioned iron and manganese a few minutes ago. Can you elaborate on what this audience member thought he heard regarding preventing iron manganese in suspension?
Okay, the iron and the manganese in a particulate sedimented form in the bottom will often be cleaved off of whatever they're attached to that's keeping them out of solution by bacterial activity when there's no oxygen. The iron and the manganese then move into the water column as soluble reduced iron and manganese. If you expose them to oxygen and you oxidize them, they go back to an insoluble state eventually. In the case of iron, it happens very fast, hours. In the case of manganese, it takes days. So the point being that if you're trying to prevent iron and manganese from accumulating, you can afford to have it go anoxic and then hit it with oxygen further down the reservoir or whatever else and get the iron out, but it's not going to work for the manganese. You need to get to it before it ever gets out of the sediment. Hopefully that's answering the question.
Okay, thank you. And a question for Dan or Megan. I'm not entirely sure whether this question is directed at you, and it's possible that other presenters have an opinion of this particular system. But there's been a question posed, I think, of ResSim.
Jennifer, the question I'll answer, since we have a model that we like to use, and I'm trying not to be commercial here, the question that you need to answer when you are choosing a model for doing dynamic reservoir operations is whether or not it will simulate all of the kinds of options that you want to try, and whether it will do that with fair facility so that it doesn't cost a fortune to do that kind of analysis. Some models will run on timescales, for example, of a month. Some will run on a day. You need to look at whether or not the operations that you're thinking about doing are, in fact, a month or a day. Some will let you do lots and lots of simulations, and I tend to favor those because they allow you to learn what works about certain operating policies and what doesn't work about other operating policies, and allows you to design an operating policy sort of as you go. If you have a model that takes a long time to run, it's much more difficult to do that learning experience as you go along. ResSim is developed by the Corps of Engineers. It's a well-supported model. It, to my knowledge, does what it's advertised to do, which is a very good thing. And it is a fairly flexible model. I prefer mine better, but that's a matter of my preference.
Thank you, Dan. And Mary, getting back to the Catawba Wateree, very complex study with a lot of different players. I'm excited to see what the final report shows. There is a question here. Will you be updating water demand projections as part of the next phase?
Yes, we are updating the water demand projections right now. We're kind of reevaluating everything that was initially done in terms of incorporating updated demand projections. I mean, as you can imagine, we've even lost the industries, et cetera, as well as habits have changed with all the water conservation that had come in as part of the drought. Even some of the industries that still remain have water conservation in place. So we are in the process of redoing all of the demand projections and then taking a closer look at the model code and how that's all integrated for the future study or the study we're working on right now.
That's great. Thanks, Mary. And we're just at about 4:30. I do appreciate everyone's time. Thank you to our presenters. Certainly very pleased at the audience participation here and the questions that have come in. There are a few here that we can't get to today, and I do want to observe your time and draw this particular webcast to a close. My contact information is available here on the screen. If you have any follow-up questions or information needs regarding anything that you heard today, please do contact me. We will be providing a recording of this webcast and posting it on our website within the next week or two. I also want to remind the group that there will be a short exit survey when this webcast is complete, and we do appreciate your input. So thank you very much for your participation today, and have a great day.